to the book, Messiah Modi, by HarperCollins and written by you, is a revealing chronicle of Mr. Modi's regime so far. It traces your journey from being such an enthusiastic supporter. I personally have followed you for so many years. I remember 2013, way back then, you were really a very, very enthusiastic supporter of his, and now to a disillusioned observer. Indeed, a very hard-hitting reckoning of Mr. Modi's premiership is this book, Messiah Modi. So what was the reason and the need to write this book, especially when you, as a seasoned and a popular and somebody who's, as I mentioned, not averse to controversy journalist, wrote this knowing that there'll be a backlash?
Well, to tell you the truth, I didn't know that there would be a backlash because the book was commissioned by HarperCollins in 2018, September. And they wanted it to come out at the same time as the 2019 election. So it was mostly written before. I just updated it after that. They wanted a fair account, you know, of his first term in office. And so they asked me to write the book. So that's the reason why I wrote it. I would not have written it on my own because I actually didn't think of the need for it. They did. HarperCollins wanted this book written. And then my suggestion was that we wait till the election results rather than, you know, because otherwise it would be irrelevant, you know, unless. So we waited for the election results. And I'm very glad that we did, because then it becomes more meaningful because, you know, I take it right up to the agitations over the Citizens, Amendment Act. And so that's the story of the book. But I wanted also to put the perspective on what had made him such a big figure in Indian politics. And to me, which I recount in the book, the state of India in 2013 was really gloomy. I don't know whether you remember it. The economy was in the doldrums. We had Mama Sonia with only one aim in life, to promote, you know, her little sunny boy as everyone in the Congress party, almost every MP was the son of someone or the daughter of someone. And here was this man who came from nowhere and who luckily for us had no children, you know? So he actually seemed like a man who could make that difference that India needed so badly, you know? I remember, and I recount the trust, I remember traveling in Rajasthan after he made his first speech at the Sriram College of Commerce in Delhi. That was his first step towards becoming prime minister. And, you know, ordinary people in villages which had voted Congress said to me, "Ke ji, hum to Modi ko vote denge." And I said, "Kyun?" And they said, "Ji, hum inki ye jo baatein kar rahe hain humko bahut pasand hai. Kyunki ye arthvyavastha ko mazboot karne ki baatein kar rahe hain, rozgar dene ki baatein kar rahe hain." And, you know, I mean, that was the big appeal because Congress, after 70 years, had kept India desperately poor. Why should India be a poor country? We have every state in India, almost every state in India, could actually make their economy strong just on tourism. And the first prime minister to talk about that was Modi. You know, I mean, look at a state like Bihar. And if you drive from, say, Patna to Bodh Gaya, just out of the Buddha's story, Bihar could be a rich country. But they didn't take that route, you know? And I'm very sad that actually, even though they look as though they're winning Bihar again, they still haven't done that. You hear Nitish Kumar saying, "Ke jo samudr kinare jo rajya hote hain, wahan pe udyog lagte hain. Yahan pe kaun aayega? Forget the udyog, just to tourism." You know, I mean, look at, we've got mountains, we've got beaches, we've got more tourism potential than almost any other country in the world. And it's unexploited because we're still trying to give jobs and, you know, we're trying to follow China's path, and that path is gone. you know, we've got to now find a new road. And I really hope that he still finds it.
See, I personally would definitely admit that this book is indeed a free-flowing read. And I would definitely recommend to those who closely follow the Modi government and are keen observers of Indian policies in general. Your writing, Tavleen, is definitely accessible. I mean, it is very fluent read. But I would really like to know if you would personally like to recommend this book, as I was discussing with you earlier, to Modi ji. And why do you think he should read it?
I think he should read it because I actually think it's a very honest critique of his first term in office. You know, it's... my criticism of him starts with demonetization, which I think was a big mistake, and with Yogi Adityanath being made, chief minister of UP at a time when there were already the lynchings of Muslims. And, you know, I mean, it's for me, India, what I'm really proud about as an Indian is that we've managed to keep a liberal democracy alive in a very poor country, in a country that had nothing else, but it had the idea of the Sanatan Dharma, you know, which is an open idea, which does not target anybody particularly, and which allows you the freedom, because our idea of secularism comes from that. You know, that the state, it has nothing to do with it. It's if you want to worship Hanuman, go right ahead and do that. And if you want to keep a fast for Santoshi Ma, do that. You know, I mean, that is what's the beauty of India. And I feel that this kind of uniform Hindutva that is being banged down our throats is a big mistake. It's not, it won't work. And it'll just create more divisions in a country that is already showing signs of very serious divisions.
One thing which I really, you know, I've read your book and I've read about you so many times. And one thing I really want to know, what is one factor in your personality which really keeps you going against everything which goes negative at times? We've read your tweets, we have read about it. So what is one personality and what is one message you want to give to people here, the way you keep going strong against all odds?
I'm by nature quite optimistic and hopeful. And I've been doing yoga for about 30 years. And I do it almost every day. Like the Prime Minister, we have that in common. And I find that you know, on a day that I can't do it, that I start to feel a bit low, etc. So I think that yoga, I don't do much meditation because I'm not very good at meditation. I try very hard. But also, you know, I'm very proud of being Indian. I'm very, you know, I want to see India. I'm 70 years old now. And, you know, I really hoped that Modi would be the man who would change India. You know, there have been moments of great change that I've seen, you know. Narasimha Rao transformed India. Atal Bihari Vajpayee did his bit. Manmohan Singh, you know, there was a transformation that had happened. There were people, instead of, you know, there was a time when I first became a journalist, when the only jobs in India were government jobs. Everybody wanted a government job, whether they wanted it as a peon or whether they wanted it as a bada saab, the only jobs were government jobs. And then because of those reforms that Narasimha Rao brought about, suddenly there were gyms and restaurants and, you know, there were jobs everywhere in places you'd never think of. Hotels started to open. Do you know, it really made huge changes. That is what I find missing in, since Modi became prime minister, that, you know, that kind of really big transformation hasn't happened yet.
In 2019, Mr. Ashok Kumar Upadhyay, he filed an RTI, and the RTI was, the question was, how many press conferences Prime Minister Modi has done so far? Please provide date/location. And the PMO's response to this was, the Prime Minister's interactions with press are structured and unstructured. and therefore information asked for is not available on record. Now, my question to you, given this context, is, do you view this selective interviews, press interaction as undemocratic, or is it a political strategy to not engage in discourse and direct discourse? That is the part A of my question. The part B of the question is, why are journalists and organizations like the Press Club of India, why are they mute spectators to this kind of a totalitarian methodology of communication?
Okay, for a start, I want to say that there is a precedent for it. Sonia Gandhi has never given a press conference. And it is undemocratic. It's actually the right of the media to demand press conferences. When I met him, the last time that I met him, when I went to give him my book in 2016, I suggested to him that he should do what the White House does, which is that you have a team of people who handle, you know, the media every day, right? But he, because he feels that the media was unfair to him after 2002, he doesn't really like journalists very much, unless they praise him. But you see, also again, the messiah complex, you know, when you're a political leader, even Trump, when he came to India, do you remember that he gave a press conference at which Modi didn't come? That's unprecedented. Normally the two leaders have to come together and give a press conference. And, you know, I think that it's very, very wrong what he's doing. Because you can't do this, you know, monkey bath, and then you ask somebody like Akshay Kumar to come and interview you, and his first question is, "Ji, aapko aam kis tarah ke pasand hai?" You know, I mean, this is, it's not a political question, right? So I feel that he really, if he wants now to be seen as a real leader and not a messiah, he must start having press conferences. He can answer the questions. You know, he has to answer them. Exactly. And, you know, instead of that, you've got this management of the media, which I've been writing about. And, you know, it's very wrong.
And what about the totalitarianism? The methodology of communication.
It is signs.
One-sided.
It is signs of a totalitarian mentality. And that is very worrying.
Ma'am, I'm very curious as to when you mentioned about the press conference, what was his answer? As in, why does he not have this precedent?
He didn't say anything. But he said, media mein samajh nahi paya hun. You know, he didn't actually give me a direct answer. But even his ministers don't question him.
Exactly.
Forget the media. I want no, you know, other than say Mr. Gadkari, who has tried to, you know, question some of the things that the bureaucrats have done. You've got a cabinet that is silent.
Exactly. I remember I was seeing some interview that was interrupted in between that he had done, I think, back in 2002, even before he was a chief minister, or just when he was elected. And I remember that interview that he walked off because he was not...
Karan Thapar,
exactly. Yeah. So, yeah. And that is the extent of what I've seen when it comes to him giving an interview, which is not, you know, structured beforehand.
No, it's not good for him. It's not good for him. Because do you know that after the emergency, Indira Gandhi was asked what she would have done again if she had a chance. And she said, "I would never have imposed press censorship." Because you see, the media is actually not just a watchdog, it's also a source of information for government, exactly. Right? And if there's no interaction with the media, how are you going to find out what people are saying? So for instance, what you just said, if he could just walk down Crown Place and see the number of people who become homeless, or in the village in which I live, if he could see that in the bazaar, there are these young men who have no jobs, and they're sitting there like, you know, I'm just waiting for any job. He should be, you know, he should be listening to those voices.
That's very true. And, you know, when we look at US also, when there is Donald Trump, you've seen over the last 4 years, so much of criticism has happened. And people have come out and very openly joked about him, talked about him, and there was no censorship. So I think that is a very important precedent, actually, which is in favor of Donald Trump, oddly.
Yes. Yes. And you know, he knows how to handle the press. When he sees those CNN guys, he says, you don't come near me. You guys are really bad guys. I'm not talking to you and all that. But that's better than not talking to the media.
Exactly.
We have Modiji as our only hope. That's one thing. We have Arvind Kejriwalji coming up with new, you know, very, very small initiatives that are very smart. Mm-hmm. Why can't our political leaders take the best from each other and build a stronger country? Why can't we talk country? Modiji has vision. He definitely has vision. Why can't we put our resources together and talk about our country? This is something that I ask myself very often. Have not found an answer. And so I'm asking you, Tavleenji,
he's governing in isolation. You know, if he was governing with, if he took along the chief ministers, if he had regular meetings with them to ask them what their problems were, what their ideas are, this is missing. This is not there. All he talks to, I don't want to mention a name, but a chief minister was sitting with the chief secretary. And the chief secretary said to the chief minister, I have to go now because the prime minister has called. And the chief minister said, what do you mean you have to go? You're here as my secretary. But he was right from the beginning talking to chief secretaries, to bureaucrats, and not to the political leaders, you know? And it's the politician that has his ear closer to the ground because he has to get reelected. The bureaucrat, once he gets a job, he's there till he's in his dotage, you know. So I think that's a big mistake he's made. And I really hope he starts listening to his he needs a team.
Yeah, I am sure he's listening. Sure he's listening there because, and we'll make him listen too.
It's also good. It's the duty of citizens also to make him listen.
Yeah, we'll make him listen to because we have to see the change. I like our presence on the world map and we'll have it there economically too. Incorrigible optimist is my funda, Anita.
Let me tell you one thing. If India booms, all our political problems disappear.
Absolutely.
There will be no problem in Kashmir. The Pakis will want to join the United States of South Asia. We have no political problems in the subcontinent if India gets its economic story to really move.
Right.